coach track record, what I don't want to say all about, because you can ask her later. The awesome thing for Bonnie is she has two great programs. The first one, let me see it right. The first one, age esteem. How does that sound?
Yeah.
There you are. And the other one is inspired women lead. I like that one as well. So a whole lot of material, all represented in Bonnie, so we will dive into that, I'm pretty sure. Then we have Saskia Harkema from the Netherlands. And Saskia has a huge background in the scientific world, isn't it? So education, you know, the facts and figures we figured out. But how do you do that the feminine way? I really am curious to hear about feminine leadership in that way, that world. And we have Herma Bouwman, isn't it? Herma Bouwman. And just climbing up that corporate ladder, and just doing it all. Well, I looked at your LinkedIn profile. I saw some changes every now and then. But we spoke up front and we said, well, okay, how do we integrate the feminine values, the femininity into the corporate world? And I'm involved in the group called the Global Institute for Extraordinary Women. And they asked me, what, Nienke, are you standing for? And say, I am the feminine way. Are you with me? So here, we're creating the female wave of change. So I like to have this real connection with you and just see how the feminine way occurs. Bonnie, first can I ask you just to introduce and then I get you all in. What is for you the feminine way?
First of all, the feminine way is to say thank you so much for having me here. I am delighted every time I'm able to be in front of a group of women who want to make a difference. It's pure pleasure. I'm not part of that 90% or 80%, whatever it was. The feminine way for me is very, it's inclusive of so much. I'd like to, could I take time to just say three values?
Yes.
That I think are so essential for the future and that we bring, given the confidence to be ourselves, to be our authentic feminine selves. First is what I'm going to call spirituality. And spirituality to me is this empathy, it's the caring, it's this natural reaching out to help others. It's an inherent part of who we are. Secondly, I would say it's we want to collaborate. You know, they say a man needs a woman. What a woman needs is a group of girlfriends. And there's so much truth to that because collaboration is a way of life for us. We help each other with the kids. We help each other for business difficulties or conundrums. So this idea of collaboration, and that also is inclusiveness. It's reaching out to each other no matter how different we are, how similar we are, what we look like, what we act like. And the third value that I think is absolutely essential, and something we bring to the world, is the holistic approach. We don't just look at what's in it for me, we look at it as what's in it for us. What is this going to mean to the future? What does this mean to it? We just saw it. What does this mean to my children, my grandchildren, my great-grandchildren? So it's looking into the future. And if I could just say, this is what Inspired Women Lead is all about. And it's why it comes together so well with the female wave of change. It's because it is making this difference in the world. Inspired Women Lead is a mentoring program that is cross-cultural, cross-border, to champion women to step into their global leadership as their authentic feminine selves. In other words, Don't try to slip into the mailbox like just another letter.
I like that. Hashtag mailbox with a type of mail. Mailbox. Yeah.
Yes, and I will stop there for the moment.
Yeah, let's connect with the audience here, because I want to know, do you recognize the values, Ineke? Do you recognize the values from Bonnie? Can you respond to her?
Yeah.
What resonates with you?
Well, actually, all three of them.
Do you have a microphone?
Can I stand here?
Are you sure?
No. No, all three of them resonate with me, because the spirituality, I was like surprised that you put that first, because the way I look at life is that this is a spiritual journey. And by naming that as the first value, I applaud you, because I think that is the ground purpose for living.
Can we just have by show of hands who agrees? Well, yeah. We are in a good place.
So
I can see it's 90% at least.
And you don't have to agree.
No, of course not. Of course not. What's that, Sandra?
It has a microphone in it.
So we run that around and it works.
Just throw it.
With two frozen shoulders. Thank you very much. All right. Yeah.
A little bit of exercise. Just a little.
I am going to ask for a volunteer. Who likes to be my personal assistant in throwing? Yeah.
Come here.
Then you can do all your Facebook Live stuff. You know, we like to do it all together. Throw box, cash box, not mail box. All the boxes here. Great.
Get rid of the box.
What I like. Get rid of the box. Yeah. What I like so much about what you said is just collaborate together, and that's why we all here. Just doing it together. It's the feminine way. And what did we say? What you want to have the hashtag from? Was it the ripple effect instead of the wrinkle effect? Now, if you age, no, you get your lovely showing of age. And I said to Bonnie, well, you can touch a ripple effect on my forehead. And she said, oh, can I have that? Because I like that for the ripple effect, just to change it from wrinkles. Because it's showing experience what we all have. Sure. Where's your mic? Oh, you have your mic.
I'd like to just share a passage from my grandmother's memoirs, because I think it sums up everything I just said. And my grandmother, Jenny Elvira Bluefield, was a tiny little woman that you would think didn't have all the spunk that she did. But I'd just like to read a short passage. She said, ours was an inheritance worth much to us, and we in turn have passed it on to our children. Listen to her list. Our list includes practical common sense, courage in facing everyday living with faith, hope, and zest, making do with little, and enjoying sharing with others of our money, time, and special talents. I like this because I think it just sums up all three of the values that I just shared.
Really great. Thank you. I'd like to go to the other side. Saskia, what is for you? How does it occur, the feminine way, in your field of expertise? Can you share a bit? And just throw questions to the audience. We have a throw box, so we can do something.
If you speak about my role as an educator, one of the things that we ask children is, what do you want to become? And I always say, you are someone. You don't have to become something. And I think this is really the heart of what education is, that we somehow push our children to be something that they maybe cannot achieve. And what is so important is that they understand from the moment that they are born that the fact that they are is already sufficient. And for me, that is what female leadership is about. And I also want to refer to my work with refugees, because I work a lot with refugees, and they come from war-torn countries. And why do I mention that? Because it's women which are the backbone of all the families suffering the insufferable. And for me then, what I've seen with working with them is that female leadership is about courage. The courage to do what is necessary and to go beyond your own individual self and your individual goals, but strive for something that is necessary.
Is that something what we can learn from refugees, or are we doing it all ourselves every day? How much courage do we have? How much willingness to step up as that cornerstone and just build up something totally new? Is that something what we do every day, or can we learn from the refugees from that? Throw box. Yay!
Just throw.
Yeah. 1, 2, 3.
Okay, be prepared.
Well, just catch, just give it a shot. Ditta.
I think that we learn from listening to our inside intuition. And I think the people that come here, they did that. So the answer is yes and yes.
Okay. So we have it already and we can learn from refugees. Is that sum up?
The refugees that came here, they listened to their intuition. They knew they shouldn't be there where they came from. They knew they had to go and had to leave to save themselves.
Yeah.
But also to show the world that we're all global people. We're not just living in a country.
Great. Yeah, just throw it around.
I just remember the story of the mice. If the cheese goes away, there's two reactions. Either quickly change and find new cheese, or keep thinking, well, the cheese was always here, so I'll stay here. So to be flexible, to be ready for change and find new cheese is the challenge everybody has.
Yeah, great. Thank you for sharing. Hema, I want to go to you. You have the experience in the corporate field, and personally I work a lot in the corporate field as well. And sometimes I call them with love and compassion, I have to deal with baboons. Do you know baboons? They're lovely. They're really lovely. You feed them bananas and they go mad. But that's probably not what you would like to have as a change there, because we talked a bit. Can you feed the audience with your experience? Because I know you have some values you want to bring into that corporate field.
Yeah, I think personally I would say that the female ways of change, and especially in the corporate world, is not something what we turn around. I mean, we need facts, we need figures to prove. But the way how to deal with it is actually, I would say, the part what we as a female needs to change. So it's not only about the facts and the figures, but mainly about how are we then really dealing with our people, dealing with our teams, to make actually the real change. And I think that's...
Can you make it practical for me? I like practical stuff. You know, I'm a doer as well, make waves. So how does that occur in your... do you have a practical example?
Yeah, I mean, I'm now for about 6 weeks, I would say, fully in a new company. And I've... Big team, 35, which will people all around the world as well. But also it's about this connecting of the team. So one of the guys, just as an example, went for a triathlon, I think 2 weeks ago. I was curious, really, personally, how he did it. So I knew it was Saturday, so Sunday morning, I went onto the internet, find out, I would say, what was his result? I didn't know anything about his PR, not at all. But I actually sent him a message Sunday morning, 7 o'clock in the morning, to say, I see you were number one. Really, congrats. And he came back on a Monday and he was totally flabbergasted. Mm-hmm. He really said, no one ever told me this. I said, I'm really impressed. So why are we not sharing these kind of thinking? I mean, I can tell you, the guy is flying high. Not because I would say he's doing a different job. No, he's exactly doing the same as before. But it's because he gets a little bit more, I would say, this female attention.
How is the female attention what you give to your environment? Let's throw the box around.
And the box is here, eh?
Yeah, it just broke somewhere. Yay! Hello!
We are very good in saving other people.
Just rescuing. Yeah, yeah.
I think, if I go to myself, my living and what I hear and what I see and what I feel, is it all starts with consciousness. Having the courage to start consciousness and to speak it out and to dare to be yourself.
How does it look like in your real world? Because this is a sort of abstract, I like it practical. Can you give a practical example how you do it?
I do it like every day when I'm on the street or I see somebody or something happening. The consciousness is always there because the intention that I feel is you're awake. I mean, you see somebody just want to cross the road. It's maybe an older people, and you see that they're like
wobbly.
Can I wobbly? And you just do it. You don't even think about it. And all these little or big things are in the company or in my case in my practice. How do you hear? How do you see? How do you feel? In your field of energy.
Yeah, great.
So it can be everything, and it starts with the intention, the right intention, and consciousness. I think.
The awareness around what's
and
going on.
What I think also is that we have a lot of work to do in just creating our ways open in the male world. I mean, it just doesn't stop with politics and with the companies. It's way. I think
that's an interesting point of view. Where do we start? Shall we ask the panel where they think they have to start? You can keep the box and just throw it a bit later. Where do we start, girls? Just go ahead. Bonnie. I see something. Yay! Going on.
We start by being our authentic feminine selves. And I love what you just said. Thank you so much, because you just described what this is. Because it's up to us to set the new standard. Mm-hmm. We're not there, we'll go back to the mailbox. We're not there to fit into the mailbox. We're there to set new standards. New standards that appreciate families, new standards where women have big enough restrooms, so if this room were full and we all needed to go at the same time, there'd be enough stalls for all of us. And that may sound minor, but we need new standards.
Did you see there was a case for court? There was so many toilets for men in Amsterdam, and one of the women got a penalty for peeing in the wild, as we say here. and she brought it to court because she said, well, there isn't anything for women. So that's a new standard, what I just came up with, sorry. <Yeah. laughs> there is something here. Can you throw the box to, yay! I'm a former nurse, so if you're worried, I can help you. It's all right. Go ahead.
What the judge said.
No, I didn't get it, because I
heard it
preparing.
This morning on the radio. Yeah. He said, well, there are enough peeing places for men, you can try that.
Oh, that's interesting.
So now they organize a Facebook event.
Women peeing in my
toilet. Women trying to pee in male peeing places. as a statement.
Yay, great. I see just over there in the corner, just hop the box around there in that corner. Yeah, just help each other, just to the back. So women are so fast and just organized and to the right place. I like collaboration. Go ahead, Maria.
Hi, thank you. I will be speaking later on, but I want to react. First of all, we helped from our law firm, the girl, with this case. But we didn't manage, because apparently the guy was the judge, so he cannot realize how it is to pee as a woman in a man's toilet. So, but something else, I want to say something about female and male energy, what you were just talking about. I have a very practical example. I'm a partner in some of businesses. One of them is a taxi company. taxi cabs in Amsterdam going to Schiphol and from around Netherlands to Schiphol. So when I just came into the company, there were only 6 guys working there. And the company was in 6 months very successful. But they said, we never pick up the phone. I was like, what do you mean? Yes, all the bookings are made online. So the calls, we don't even get them. We don't have time. We're just driving around and the mail is never being answered. And I have only girls on my team. So then I said, we will change that. So mails within 24 hours. And this is the change we women are making. We are nurturers. We're trying to help our clients, to nurture them, and we see them as our children. And men, they only think about money.
So not all of them. You have in your males with feminine energy. But I'd like to bring that back to Herma and to Saskia. Saskia, you are able to answer.
Well, I think it all starts with education, to be honest. And if I look at what we teach children, starting from primary school to university, it's, I would say, 80% based on male values. So whether it's leadership, whether it's change management, whether it's organization theory.
Well, you get trousers from the government now if you let your boy play, you know? Is that a...
Yeah, that's, I think.
I don't know.
So it's really ingrained in our educational systems, and if we don't change that, then I'm afraid that it's going to take a very long time.
Yeah, I agree. Everybody agree, start with education as well. Just to see if everybody's awake. Yay! Great. Herma, do you have something to add?
Yeah, I think there is also, I'd say, I don't want to sound negative, but what you mainly see, I would say, by men is that they put, what they say the company value first, but actually they're referring to themselves.
What is company value?
Yeah, then they really say, okay, yeah, my goal is, I would say, then everything from the company starts, but in reality they actually refer to themselves to be higher on the ladder.
Do you recognize that, by the way, just to check if we're on the same page? Do you recognize that? Yes. Corporate values, middle-based value? Mm-hmm. All right, yeah. Great.
But, I mean, I think that's always a little bit my goal when I'm going into a company, actually. I'm willing to support the company, but not for me, but actually to be redundant in a certain time frame. That my team is able to make the decisions, my team is doing it, and I could be, I would say, the lazy girl somewhere in the back, to really say, okay, but it goes nice, I'm happy. And because my team is, I would say, taking the ownership and taking the responsibility. And I think that's much more, I would say, the value we need to go into the future. So it's not to drive for only the goals and the perspective of the company, but mainly to empower the people and to make sure, I would say, that the team is able to lead. And I think that's a total different way of leadership than what is always said before. But I think that's the biggest change what I'm, I would say, willing to implement or at least transfer into the organization I'm working for.
Awesome. May I ask something? I was wondering, if you think of challenges, what I come across is there's a lot of millennials, young people, who don't take ownership. You are talking about ownership. I see them in companies and I see them asking questions. But I also hear them saying, I have a lot of goals in life, and one of my goals is to get rich really fast. And that's, you know, I thought they wanted to drive change. I thought, and that was naive, I think, I thought that they wanted to make a better world. But they don't.
Some of them.
Yeah.
I see another other wave coming up as well. Okay, I see that as well, but I see others as well. So interesting perspective.
So what I was thinking, because I don't want this to be a negative topic. What I wanted to say is, why don't we start with ourselves? We are raising these children, and we have to do something about this.
Can I react to that?
Yeah.
Can I react to that?
Yeah, yes? Sure. And the box can go up here because we have someone waiting. Yeah.
I work a lot with millennials, many, many, many. And I think it's also a matter of perception, to be honest. So it may seem as if they're only concerned with themselves and making a lot of money, but I think if you compare them to when we were young, you know, we accepted to become an employee in a company and to be exploited. They just exploited us, you know, they squeezed us out as long as possible to make money and to make profit. And I see young people nowadays saying, a company is helpful to me to the extent that it contributes to something that I value as a person. Mm-hmm. And they just hop from one company to another. Mm-hmm. And so maybe they have gone to the other extreme. It may be in some cases that they say, I'm not for the company is for me. And somewhere maybe we have to change towards a more balanced, but I don't see it as something negative, to be honest. Mm-hmm. They're taking charge of their lives, and
in
I think that's a
way.
Very good thing.
It's
I think,
in a different way.
Yeah, I think it's a very good thing.
Yeah,
I wanted to respond to we raised the kids ourselves, and also that we need to start with education. If you look to children, you know, they are really in sync with their brains and their gut feeling and their heart. You know, they are really easy in showing their emotions, expressing their feelings. And somewhere during life, you know, we get it out of them. I don't know how, but I don't think it's only due to education. I think there is definitely something there. But also in the general society, we are shaping our kids in such a way that, you know, we don't really embrace those feminine values. So that's also why I showed the picture. It's not only due to education. It's also the society,
it's
the organization.
The whole package, isn't it?
It's the whole package, and we need to make sure that everything comes in sync again. And I think female or women are better in. Balancing everything out, you know, the brains, the heart, the gut, in comparison to male.
Yeah, let's give that a real shot in real life. I know we have just a limited time, but I would like to ask the panelists, do you have any questions for the audience? Let's turn it around. Emma, what's your question for the audience? Just to give away, what are you going to do? What will we do with the audience together? Something, give them.
I would say actually challenge them to really ask, I would say mainly thinking over driving home tonight or I would say whatever moment, but then really think over, okay, what do you want to do tomorrow different than today to make something happen?
Yeah, keep that in mind. What will you do today to make tomorrow different, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yay. Okay, do you take it on, audience? And I like to speak about the audience, not about them, but about you, because it's you, all you. So
us.
It's us. Well, you ask a question to them, so you ask what you do. Saskia, what would you like to ask?
Yes, I think I would like to ask, because I see Female Wave of Change as a movement, and yeah, Ingo. Show that it's going to grow, and what would you want this movement somehow to represent and stand symbol for? And does it have everything that you already want? And if not, then what is it that is still missing or
I'm,
that you could...
I'm pretty sure
this
contribute. Whole day is arranged to make
question.
That happen.
Yeah.
So you get all opportunities to just put all your input in that and make it practical. So what is this wave representing for you? And how do we make it practical, working, not a theory, but just doing it? Is that the whole thing?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Saskia. Bonnie?
I'd like to throw out a challenge along the same line. The undercurrent here is that the feminine is not valued. So what will each of us do to overcome our own hidden biases and make the feminine, I don't want to use the word equal, to give the true value to the feminine? And if I could just leave you with an image. When your daughter comes down dressed as Batman, you don't think a thing of it. So how about your teenage son coming down dressed as Wonder Woman?
Mm-hmm.
When you don't think a thing of that either, perhaps the feminine value is there.
All right. Mm-hmm. I do have a son and a daughter. I don't know if my 21-year-old will do something like that. Actually, can I just make a confession here? He said to his girlfriend, "You didn't shave your legs," and I become furious about it. My little frustration to share here. Sorry.
It's recorded.
Personal note. Alright. Shall we go to the box of Tudor Irene? Yay!
I was not very good at catchbox. Yeah, my name is Irene Jansen and I call myself, in English it's called happiness advocate. I think indeed we need a better balance between the masculinity and femininity both in politics and in business. And I think it's on all these different levels, and a very personal thing was kind of coming up in my mind, because it's all the levels. It's a business and politics and at home. I have he's now 8 years old, but 3 years ago I think he was prescribed glasses. So we went to go to the glass shop to get the glasses. He walked in. He says, "That one, mommy." These glasses were the best glasses because they were colorful, they were purple, and they had white and yellow flowers on it. And my heart broke because what do you do as a mother? Because I want to be the mother that, you know, gives him, you know, with the glasses that he wants and to feel confident and go out with those glasses. But at the same time, you don't want to be going into the buying new glasses tomorrow, right? I mean, I did send him to school in tights. You know, he did that once, and then he didn't speak of it anymore. And then, you know, weeks later, he was like, "Some boys start saying that you are dressed like a girl, and it's, you know, whatever, you know." Anyway, back to the glasses. It's really tricky, you know, because I stand for every person to be able to express him or herself as they like, you know, whether it's crazy or awkward or whatever.
What is crazy?
Yes, crazy. But at the end of the day, I need to send him, and that was at a Brussels school, so a very kind of international, you know, like everybody, like all nationalities going there, etc. You know, so I told him, you know, we were there at glasses. I told him, "Well, if you want, I will buy you the glasses, but I don't know what will happen when you go to school, right?" And then that was just, I mean, it was just awful. He really quickly, he was 5 years old, right? He quickly realized what was
happening. What you really said.
What I said. I saw it in his face, like my heart broke. And then he picked out, you know, the black round glasses, the ones that you were given by the
Harry Potter,
like 50 years ago.
Harry Potter.
The most invisible, the most, I mean, I was even saying because they had the purple one without the flowers, so I was kind of trying to put them, for him, that.
What would you say to the rest of the audience? What do we do?
And this is the thing, as long as you're aware of the fact that that there's always this tension, you know. Like when I work with women change makers, there's always this tension that as a woman, when you step into your femininity, you get judged much harsher than when you do it as a man. There is this, you know, nice and competent.
I will tell you, we'll dive in that afternoon. So don't bother. It's covered here.
Fine, I'll give it to you then. But so I think the first thing is be aware of it and sometimes have the courage to, okay, you know, I didn't have it with glasses, but to send your kid to school in tights, you know.
Yeah. Robin did as well. He'd conquer the world in a different way. All right.
May I react on this?
And yeah, you're wrapping up because I got the signal already.
I only have, I would say, two sentences to say. Just as an feedback to all, my former boss mentioned to me, and I think it's one of the best I've ever heard, even though there is, I would say, a man part in, I still like it, because he always said, "Shy guys don't get pretty girls." But you can use it for everything. So keep that in mind, and maybe we should turn out, I would say, turn around this saying that shy girls don't get pretty boys.
Mm-hmm.
But that's actually what it is about.
All right. Really, really great.